Welcome to the Coastal Garden. You know, it's late summer. Things are changing in the garden. Day's getting a little shorter. Temperatures starting to fall off. And that means some things you need to deal with, problems and issues culturally that we'll talk about later on in the show. Our last segment for this show is a little different than normal, though. We're going to join a nurseryman friend of mine down at the NCNLA, which stands for the North Carolina Nursery and Landscape Association, which is a group of professionals who support each other, help support us here in Extension, and also do a lot of work for all of you guys out there in the landscape, turf, and horticultural professions. Before we do that, though, we'll have Matt Martin, our turf guy here. He's got some great information about taking care of your lawn as we move into the cooler parts of the year. And speaking of problems, we have some issues that have come up. We've had a wet summer, and we have some typical insect problems. So I've got a few problems I want to talk to you about that are more related to the ornamental shrub side of things rather than the lawn and turf. One of them is azalea lacebug. Now, you know, we love our azaleas around here. We have the North Carolina Azalea Festival here, big part of our landscapes. And the most common insect pest that's reported in North Carolina is one on azalea called azalea lacebug. Fairly easy to detect. If you walk up to the plants, you'll notice that you see what we'd call a stippled leaf. What that means is it looks like somebody took a tiny little needle and poked holes in it, and the chlorophyll collapses. So you get these kind of straw-colored brown spaces on the leaf where you don't have the nice green part with the chlorophyll in it. If you flip that leaf over, you may see the lacebug themselves, but you'll also see the little black specks, and the eggs are laid under those little black specks by the females. Looking really closely, you'll probably see the adults this time of year, and you'll see the reason we call them lacebugs. They have these clear lace-like wings. You may also see these kind of spiny black nymphs that don't have wings. That's kind of the in-between stage between the egg and the adult. Azalea lacebugs are not hard to control, but you do need to direct the material to the underside of the leaf. That's especially true if you're trying to avoid the true insecticides. If you're trying to use insecticidal soap or some of those other products, make sure that you contact the body of the insect with that. With the insecticides, not quite as critical, but since this critter is on the underside of the leaves, you need to direct that spray underneath there. One question people might ask is, what happens if I don't do anything? If you have azaleas that are constantly attacked and azalea lacebugs are not controlled, it will weaken the plant over time. Probably not going to kill the plant in and of itself, but it is something you need to look for right now. Turn some leaves over to look for the azalea lacebug adults and nymphs, and control them if you see them out there, an active population. Any of the insecticides, the old malathion products, even things like 7, imidacloprid, bifenthrin, the typical stuff you would buy at a mass merchandiser will control azalea lacebug with no problem. Another problem we've seen a lot of this year, because it has been pretty wet most of the summer, is we've seen these fungal leaf spots on a lot of different plants. You see things like cornosporium on hydrangea, entomosporium on things like Indian hawthorn, black spot on roses. All of these are fungal leaf spots, and they all have to have free water, moisture on the leaf surfaces to develop and cause the spotting. By this time of year, especially on plants, say like the hydrangea, that are going to drop their foliage anyway, it's probably not worth spraying anything for these fungal leaf spots. It'll make the plants look a little bad. You may see some of the leaves drop early, but it's not really worth worrying about a whole lot. The plants have pretty much done what they're going to do as far as growing this year anyway. So probably the best thing to do with those is try to ignore them and don't worry about it, and don't waste the time and the money buying fungicides and applying it to these fungal leaf spots on these ornamental shrubs. On the flip side of that coin, though, we have seen some of this when we've had some fairly hot spells toward the end of August. We've seen some scorch, and we talk about this, you know, sometimes, especially after a year like last year when it was really dry. You see the margins or the edges of certain plants just kind of get crispy and turn brown. And that problem is called scorch. And all that means is the plant is losing more moisture than it can take up. So plants like this little flowering dogwood here at the Arboretum, a young plant doesn't have a lot of roots out there to take up water, shallow-rooted plant to begin with. That's where you're going to see a lot of scorch on plants like that. Japanese maples that are in a lot of sun, plants that are young, haven't been in the landscape very long, you're going to see that. It's not a disease, it's just a physiological response to being hot and relatively dry. So nothing to worry about. This little dogwood looks bad right now, but it'll be fine. So if you have a plant like that that doesn't have a good mulch cover, maybe adding a little bit of mulch, not as long as it's not more than about 3 inches or so over the root area, putting a little supplemental water, a soaker hose or something underneath that canopy just to help it through that last few hot periods of late summer. But really nothing too much to worry about. So if you're dealing with the problems on the shrubs, make sure you do look for the azalea lacebug, because that is something that's probably worth treating. But the scorch and the fungal leaf spots, something you probably can just ignore. Stay with us after the break. Matt Martin, our turf guy, will join us with some great lawn care tips. Welcome back. We've got a treat for you. We have our turf guy, Matt Martin, who works with the Crop Science Department at NC State, does a lot of work in the eastern part of North Carolina with golf courses and sod farms, and helps us out here. So welcome to the Coastal Gardener, Matt. We appreciate you joining us again. We're here in September. Some things happening, kind of warm season grass is kind of slowing down a little bit. Nights getting a little cooler, days are shorter. What should we be worried about with the fertilizer?
Well, you know, Al, it's getting a little late to do what most people typically think about fertilizing on their yards, and that's putting out nitrogen, the part of the fertilizer that makes your grass or your plants grow. The fertilizer that most people and your grass will benefit from now is the last number on the bag, potassium. And potassium will help your grass be a little stronger through the winter season, will aid in the root structure of your grass, aid a little in drought tolerance. And you know, there was actually something that was released by the Department of Agriculture a few weeks ago. I saw where all the rain, they were seeing a depletion of a lot of nutrients in the soil. They released that statewide and a lot of their soil sample results. So it's not a bad idea to add potassium to your turf this time of the year.
Well, potassium, I guess, would especially be an issue in our sandy soils.
That's right.
And certainly something that, as you mentioned, with a lot of rainfall, a lot of irrigation is going to leach out. So anytime we sample our sandy soils, just about always they're low in potassium.
That's right.
So
that's right.
What you're doing is a stress tolerance thing, heat, drought, cold, all
yep.
those kind of things. So last number on the bag, we've got a bag here of 0020.
Yep.
Some people call that Sulpomag, is also sold as 0022. That's one of the ones that I like because it's got a little magnesium in it.
Yep.
Do you have any preferences on that?
No, that's a great carrier. The good thing about this is that having only 20% of that being potassium, it's not such a high analysis, not such a high percentage of product in that bag. You can put out, you know, 3 to 5 pounds of this product per 1,000 square feet. That'll give you a good amount of potassium. If you get something with a higher number, you're left putting out a very small amount of product. As well as, like you say, the turf down here many times will benefit from magnesium. Mm-hmm. You'll get that extra color that your turf was missing with the addition of magnesium to the turf. So oftentimes that's a micronutrient that we do miss out in our fertilizer applications. A lot of times you can buy a fertilizer source that's got those in there, but most of the time we don't do that.
Yeah. So the Sulpomag, the 0022 or 0020 is a good thing to use.
Yep.
What about Bermuda grass? If you look at NC State's basic recommendations, you're calling for a little bit of nitrogen in September. Tell us a little bit about that and what you might do with it.
Yeah, you know, Bermuda grass is the only grass that we do recommend a late summer, early fall feeding on. Typically, you can do that with a product like a 5-10-30 or a 5-10-20, a starter fertilizer. Mm-hmm. Works very well for that. You know, Bermuda is just a hungry grass by nature, and what we see quite often with giving it just a small amount of food in the fall like that is it'll green up a little sooner in the spring.
Mm-hmm.
You'll have a little better turf quality through the fall. You know, our grass might stay green until Thanksgiving or after some years, so there's several months there where it's not growing very much, but it's still green, and that little bit of nitrogen will help, as well as the potassium that you put out with that.
Okay, well, that's good information on the potassium and also a little bit of nitrogen for the Bermuda grass. You said you've been seeing some fall armyworms this year, so tell us a little bit about what the damage will look like and where you'd expect to see it most often.
So fall armyworms are a worm that come from, that they develop from moths that fly into this region, usually in the midsummer. They lay eggs on trees, fences, not in the grass, and then they walk out and feed on the turf. You know, Bermuda grass tends to be usually 99% of the time, that's the turf we see them in, our Bermuda grass yards. We have a few seashore paspalum yards on some of the barrier islands that I've talked to some lawn care companies that they're really getting eaten bad as well. Normally it's Bermuda grass and none other. You don't have to worry about them in Zoysia, Centipede, or St. Augustine. But if you have Bermuda grass and you're mowing it, and you see a lot of blackbird activity out on the yard during the day, and the birds stay there and look like they're feeding, that's a very good indication. The real indication will be you'll go mow it, and after you mow it, you'll look like you have really cut a lot of the leaves off, the understory of the grass has turned brown, mm-hmm. and over that next week, a lot of times it really won't green back up like it has previously.
Okay. So what should we, let's say we find a problem with fall armyworm, maybe it's already done some damage, maybe you can't even find the worms anymore, what would you recommend?
Well, a timely insecticide application is most important because they're easy to kill, but they're going to stay there and continue to feed until they completely defoliate the grass mm-hmm. in areas. Almost any insecticide labeled for turf will kill fall armyworms. Particularly the ones that are the synthetic pyrethroids, bifenthrin, mm-hmm. Cyfluthrin, what we commonly sell as Talstar.
Right.
Those work very well. Sometimes you have to treat twice. Mm-hmm. If you have a heavy infestation, you need to treat, and then in several, maybe 2 weeks, come back and treat again. You'll have pupa that emerge that have been, most of the time, by the time you find the army worms, you have a complete life cycle of moths, pupa, and eggs all going on in that environment around. So usually if you find a few or they're defoliating your grass, you will need to treat at okay. least once, maybe twice.
Okay. Well, the fall armyworm, as you mentioned, is usually on Bermuda grass,
yep.
usually a lot of the hybrids especially, I guess, or the common also?
Yeah, common also, really any type of Bermuda grass they okay. like. They seem to like lighted areas.
Right. The moths are attracted.
The moths are attracted to the lights. So oftentimes we have communities that have a lot of lights in them, or golf courses that have a lot of lights around them, and those quite often are the ones that we find a lot of damage around.
Okay. Well, let's switch gears again. We've had a pretty wet summer
yep.
This year, a lot wetter than last year, and I'm expecting, but I'll get your opinion because you probably know more about it than I do, but I'm kind of expecting that we're going to see a lot of large patch this year. Tell the folks what large patch is, just so a lot of them have heard the story before, but a little bit about the disease and how it's going to show up and what they should do about it.
Yeah, large patch is our most prevalent disease pretty much on all the warm season grasses. With the exception of Bermuda grass, we see it very, very little, but Zoysia, St. Augustine, and Centipede are very susceptible. We've had a very wet, mild summer, and in some cases on St. Augustine and some in Zoysia, the large patch that was present in the spring has really never gone away all summer. We recommend treating for this disease usually around Labor Day or in the early part of September to make your first applications. It's a fall, winter, spring disease. It feeds on the grass when it's as it's going dormant and it's not growing and the weather gets milder. Mm-hmm. So the cooler it gets and the less your grass grows, the more susceptible it is. And the big thing is water. It's a great time to turn your irrigation off and only water manually as mm-hmm. needed. That's probably the biggest aid you can give your turf if you battle the disease, is to try to create almost a mini drought in your yard and make it very, very dry in that environment. If you can do that, sometimes fungicides, you know, are not as necessary, but if the area is wet and you can't dry it out, or if you put a lot of water on it, it's a very susceptible place for the disease.
Yeah, we get some in this crown zoysia lawn that we have here in the wedding lawn. There's an area that stays a little wetter than the other, and we always get large patch in that same spot. So.
Yeah, and as you know, Al, you battle it over here as a manager, and it's tough to predict exactly when it's going to show up. So it's a little bit of a guess as far as putting that preventative application out. But this particular fungicide, Heritage, it's very systemic, very absorbed up and down in the plant. It seems to work as well as, you know, many of the other fungicides. The advantage we see sometimes with this is a granular product you can buy. So for a homeowner, you don't have to spray it. I will say that to really get the kind of control you want in the fall, you need to put it out twice.
Yeah.
Put it out once now and once again in about a month, and that's going to help you battle the disease for a lot longer period of time.
Yeah, we've had good luck with using the isoxystrobin, and I know for us even the granular product really makes it a lot easier because of the water rates, the solution rates that you need for a sprayer. A lot of times we don't have sprayers to do that.
That's right.
So and we're in the same boat that most homeowners are, where you need to really drench that material in with a liquid. You can do the granular, and it seems to work pretty well.
Yeah, and if you are a homeowner using a liquid, you still need to water that liquid in. Mm-hmm. After you put it out and spray it, it still needs to be watered into the soil, and that's a lot of times what you do with this is you need to water it, so you'll go ahead and water it in and get it into the area where the disease is present.
You've got to move that fungicide into the crown, right?
Yep.
Okay, so we looked at a little bit of fertilization. Obviously, we're always concerned about potassium levels, especially in the sandy soils we have here in this part of the world, the fall armyworms on Bermuda grass, and dealing with the large patch on St. Augustine, centipede, and zoysia.
Yep.
Any other tips you want to pass along for September lawn care?
Well, I know we've been seeing a lot of bahia grass. That's one of the things that we've seen throughout the summer. We've had a lot of rain. You know, it's one of those grasses that works very well if you have a dry yard and you don't want to irrigate, but it can be a pretty bad weed as well if you don't want it. And those seed heads will pop up every, 3 to 5 days after you mow it.
Yeah, it's tough to mow for a lot of people.
It is.
Lawnmowers don't cut it too well a lot of times, so it is a real weed. We have some of it here that we keep battling, but it seems to me that there are some tools there. Timing's not so good right now, but maybe next spring would be a good time to go after it.
You know, a lot of people forget over the winter their bahia grass till the middle of the summer they're mowing it, but it's not hard to control with a herbicide. If you spray it in May and June, you can do a really good job controlling it.
Yeah. Well, that's great information. Matt, thanks for joining us here on the Coastal Gardener. Always appreciate you coming along and giving us some tips on how to keep our lawns looking good. That's Matt Martin, our turf guy. After the break, we're going to go to the North Carolina Nursery and Landscape Association Summer Green Show at the Wilmington Convention Center and talk to a nurseryman friend of mine. Welcome back to the show. You know, we talked a little earlier that we're going to take you down to the convention center and go to an NCNLA show. And I'll tell you what that means, or maybe Mike will later on. But let me introduce our guest. We have Mike Hudson, who is the owner of Sampson Nursery over in Godwin, right on the edge of, I guess that's Cumberland County.
No, Sampson County.
Sampson County.
Northern part of Sampson.
I guess
Sampson
that would
County.
Make sense. Would
that's it.
It's not too far from Fayetteville, though, but known Mike for a long time. But Mike, tell us a little bit about your nursery there in Godwin and what you do.
Okay, we started a nursery back in 1985. Mm-hmm. I had gotten into a business degree and realized I didn't want the business indoor type, and had an old family farm, used to build a tobacco farm, and saw the opportunity with the nursery business. We'd kind of done it as a hobby, my parents and myself and brothers had started as more of a hobby, growing and propagating azaleas. Well, that took off to be more of a business, and it got to the point where we really expanded and got into it full time. Went to NC State, got a degree in horticulture, and now the nursery is 40 acres, and I've been in business since 1985.
So 40 acres, and all of yours is in container.
All container grown, and we ship anywhere from Georgia up into New Jersey, New York. But 90% of our business is North Carolina, Virginia, and Maryland, okay, in that area. Wholesale, yeah, nursery.
I could remember, I guess that was 88, 89. I used to buy some plants from you back, yeah, in the day when I was, yeah, working at a garden center in Raleigh.
But that's right.
That was when you were just getting going there.
That's
back
right,
in those
right,
days.
We came right along just when the boom in Raleigh was going, and being in the right place at the right time helped us to develop a lot faster than what I thought, yeah, we would. So,
well, I'm glad you've had some success. I guess nurseries, everybody, landscapers, nurserymen, everybody's struggled in the economic downturn,
oh,
since,
yeah,
07. But you see any glimmers of hope there, or is it?
Yeah, it seems to. Everybody's got a good attitude. We've had, you know, 2 or 3 years of bad years or off years, and I think everybody's gone through that and realized what it takes to be successful and watch your pennies and, you know, see where everything's going. And we've all had to make cuts, but we've all learned how to do it.
Well, I'm glad you're surviving that. You got some beautiful stuff here. Let's talk a little bit about the show that we're, mm-hmm, sitting in the middle of right now. We're at the Wilmington Convention Center. This is an NCNLA show, which is the Nursery and Landscape Association. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about the association and your involvement with, mm-hmm, it.
Well, I'm on the board of directors with the association. Mm-hmm. And what the association does is just a major group of members in the landscape and the nursery industry. And what the association, the benefits of the association is, we put on these shows like this, where we can go to this part of the state this year. Next year we'll be back in Raleigh. Our winter show is always in Greensboro. Mm-hmm. And we have attendees come to the show, and it's a chance for us to exhibit and show our attendees what we have coming up for this fall or in the winter show for the spring. And they come and go through. We draw people from Virginia. I've seen some guys from Delaware in here this morning. It's a good chance for them to, you know, just get out and see what's new and, you know, what product we'll have for them for their garden centers or landscape jobs.
Well, it looks really nice in here. Of course, yeah, it's a good time for the wives and the husbands and the kids,
yeah,
to go to the beach, too.
Yeah, like great time.
But
yep.
Anyway, so the Nursery and Landscape Association also has some connections with NC State University,
yeah,
I believe, don't you, with the,
yep,
Ralston Arboretum?
Yep. Yeah, we're real involved with the Ralston Arboretum and the Extension. You guys have helped us out a whole lot. You help us out with speakers, which is also an educational part of this show. You know, we're not just here selling, but we offer a lot of classes for local landscapers and people to come in and get credit or to learn what's new or about new pesticides or new techniques in the landscaping industry and irrigation.
So the NCNLA is, you're supporting some research.
Yeah.
You're supporting some educational activities for your members and also putting on shows like this so,
yep,
people can see what you have. Well, speaking of that, you know, this, our show here, Mike, is all about plants and gardening,
mm-hmm,
and all of that. I see some beautiful stuff here, and I see some things that might not be quite so well known to the,
mm-hmm,
average gardener. What have you got out here that you think is going to really be something that gardeners out there are going to really want and,
yeah,
to add to their own gardens?
You know, the days of everybody just coming and getting bread and butter, Hella Rye and Compacta,
mm-hmm,
you know, we don't see that as much. People want something now that's got some more interest to it, whether it's fragrance or a longer bloom period, a different color bloom. Everybody likes a little bit less maintenance type plants nowadays.
Less work's always good.
Yeah, yeah, to them. And so, yeah, we like hydrangeas are really hot now, mm-hmm, a lot of the different hydrangeas. The dwarf hydrangeas, we have a few of those that don't get as big as some of the old-timey ones.
Yeah,
less
good
maintenance.
Old southern garden plant,
yep,
there.
Yep, yep. Some of the newer plants that we're in combination with the J.C. Ralston Arboretum,
mm-hmm,
is Miss Schiller's Delight Viburnum. It's a dwarf viburnum, evergreen, blooms from spring on through to the first frost. So.
Yeah, I saw that plant here. You know, you and I were talking about it,
mm-hmm,
yesterday. That's Viburnum obovatum, which,
mm-hmm,
it's a lot of the quote dwarf ones that,
yeah,
we've had in the past tended to get a little bigger than we thought they were going to, but,
right,
this one looks like one that might actually stay small.
Yeah, yeah, it looks like it's going to have good potential. Like I said, a smaller plant, evergreen. We're figuring probably around 3 to 4 feet and good blooms. I see, you know, the ones here in the show, you're seeing a lot of them on the show. It's got blooms right now.
Yeah, that'd be so great. And it fits some foundation planting, fits that smaller garden kind of location, gives
it.
You something besides those hollies. Down here it's all dwarf yopon,
yeah,
and,
yeah,
Carissa. But Anything else you're working with that you really think's got some potential?
The dwarfer types of lower petalum, mm-hmm. people really liking that. You know, everybody gets lower petalum, and it's a beautiful
plant. Which one do you like
plant.
The best?
The Daruma is still going to get big, and there's some new ones coming out. Crimson Fire, mm-hmm. supposed to mature out at about 3 to 4 feet with about a 4 foot spread.
And so, is it going to stay that small?
We're in the gardens, five years old. That's what they are now. Oh, but like good. You said, are they? We don't know. A lot of things with dwarf are just slow growing. But
what a huge success story Laura Petalum is, of course. You know, if you think about it. But any others that come to mind immediately that some gardener ought to be out there looking for?
Oh, a lot of things. But I personally like. I mean, the dwarf Nandinas. You know, something besides firepower. You have Harbor Bell Nandina, a good low spreader, gets a good berry on it where you don't see a lot of berries on the
Harbor
Dwarf.
Do that,
And repeat blooming plants, the lilac, that Bloomerang lilac is a proven winter dyke, but mm-hmm. You got a repeat bloom where you know.
How far south can you take that?
We're over in Sampson County in the Sand Hills, and it's blooming now, full bloom. So I would think it would go down South Carolina maybe.
Most people have been conditioned to think that Syringa does it, but we're talking about this common lilac like everybody grows up north. But there are some lilacs that do work here.
Yeah. So.
Well, Mike, we certainly appreciate you joining us here on the Coastal Gardeners, our show.
And
glad to see you, and glad to see you at the show, and hope you have a great show, and hope your business keeps getting better and better.
Thanks, Al. Nice seeing you again.
That's Mike Cousin. He owns Sampson Nursery over in Godwin. And that wraps up the show here on the Coastal Gardener. We're glad you joined us, and we'll look forward to seeing you next month.